Scott is a stain on our cultural memory.
I'll leave the room when it's playing in a movie. I'm just like, I'll be back when actual music is playing. Hey, welcome to Black Film School, a video series where we talk about Hollywood classics and then offer up lesser known films for the canon. Hey guys, today we're going to be talking about coming of age films. So first things first, if you have not seen Just Another Girl on the IRT or Clueless, you need to stop the video now, go watch it, come back, we'll still be here.
Clueless is just a classic 90s coming of age film. It stars Alicia Silverstone as Cher Horowitz, who is a very well-off white 16-year-old who is just navigating adolescence and also helping a new student, played by Brittany Murphy, RIP, to kind of fit in and find their place in the world.
Dee?
Sup?
Did you get your report card?
Yeah, I'm toast. How'd you do?
I totally choked. My father is gonna go ballistic on me.
Clueless is maybe one of the most important American teen films we have. And I think part of it is that it really captured the zeitgeist at that time. It's quintessential 90s. The fashion, the way that everybody's talking, even the music. And there's also the fact that Clueless was in a time where teen movies were fun. Then somewhere around like the mid-2000s, they got like very dark and very serious. So it's just a good time. Do you miss movies like this? The kind of, you know, poppy and fun coming of age films?
Well, not just poppy and fun, but I like this specific combination of poppy fun and just smart. And it's not looking down at its characters, which are all mainly girls, you know? And I think the thing, especially with its fashion, it's like when I watch Clueless, it doesn't actually bring me back to the 90s. It brings me back to me in the 90s watching Clueless because it was like just over the top, like Dion's hats. Like no one was wearing Dion's hats, you know what I mean? It was just like a little bit extra. And I think especially now when we look back at things with a kind of nostalgic worldview, we like that little bit of extra.
As a Jamaican person, I find ska personally offensive. I'll leave the room when it's playing in a movie. I'm just like, I'll be back when actual music is playing. So if you like the fashion and the parties and all of the cool teen speak in Clueless, then you might also like Just Another Girl on the IRT, which is a film from 1992 directed by Leslie Harris.
Just Another Girl on the IRT is a beautifully made debut feature film based in Brooklyn, New York. It's about a young teenager who is navigating high school with plans of graduating early and to go off to medical school to become a doctor until a wrench is thrown into her plans. And it's a fantastic, fantastic coming of age movie.
Y'all, people today be bugging. The other day I was on the number 2 train with my friend, just bugging out, having a good time. And people just started staring at us like we were some sort of street girls with no future. Yo, when I'm with my friends, I act like it don't matter because it don't.
I love this movie. It'll say every scene has a pulse, and there's like a very specific pulse whenever she's breaking the fourth wall. It's so real and so raw. I love it.
I love her clothes. Her clothes, like every scene, I'm just obsessed with her clothes. I was pausing from scene to scene watching it, just like, what is that? Where did she get it? Can I wear that now?
I always get A's and B's in all my classes. I'm the best student in my calc class.
I also love how like really just at the outset, she's subverting those, you know, tropes of what it means to be intelligent or what it means to, you know, be a part of pop culture. You can do both. Like when I was growing, I was like, either you dress like this or you're a book nerd. And she's clearly both, you know what I mean? She's very popular, charismatic, and she's very smart. And I feel like just at the outset, setting that tone was like really strong.
One of my favorite things that it does, especially at the time that it came out, was like positioning her as the center of the story world and like enacting the story world. When it's like, when you look at other movies and you look for black girls or women who are like not just aligned in terms of race and gender, but just like class and respectability, like they're always like the villains or at least the foils, you know? Like I'm thinking of like Save the Last Dance has both a villain and a foil that are like kind of unrespectable and live at that kind of class positioning. And it's like, well, now we get, it's just about her. She's a star, you know?
We've been taught that this map is geographically correct. Well, it's not. Now, you see this map over here on my left? This map is a geographically correct map.
Where did you get your information? I mean, your information can't possibly be correct.
I wrote to a Dr. Margaret Scott. She has a PhD in geographical research. She's willing to come to the class if you want her.
Continue, Chantel.
Thank you.
You know what? Yeah, that was dope.
I love this scene. I love it so much. I love that the teacher has to concede to her. So scrumptious. So satisfying.
I love the way that she says people of color. I love how she says people of color. I love, like, that's how I want to say it from now on. And sometimes it feels like such a corny thing to say people of color. And it's like, no, she made it cool.
These are definitely more in line with the experiences that I had. Like, I went to a predominantly black high school, and our teachers were using textbooks as tools to then point out hypocrisy in the textbooks and then relate them to what the truth was. And so movies like these, I instantly connected to those moments, you know what I mean? Just because this is what education was like for myself and other black people that I grew up around.
Where did you get the tank from?
I gave it to
you. Oh my God, girl, look at that!
Here's your receipt, miss. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much and have a nice day.
Damn! We spent $500 already? Get out of here! I thought we'd have got more stuff than this now.
Word, but that's all right, girl. We're gonna be looking fierce tomorrow.
This girl's having fun. Like, you never see black teenage girls having fun on screen. I mean, maybe now, but not really in 92, you know? It's like, it kind of stops at, like, little black girls, where it's like a modicum of innocence could be bestowed upon them by, like, a white audience. But you never see black teenage girls, especially black teenage girls from the hood, just having fun. It's so cute.
So this scene is, like, very anxiety-inducing, like Uncut Gems level of, oh no, oh no, oh no. Because her boyfriend gives her this $500 for an abortion, and then she takes the money, and instead of getting the abortion, she goes on a shopping spree with her friend. And I was thinking the entire time, but what if she decides later that she wants the abortion and she doesn't have the money? I like that they're having a good time. I'm still anxious though.
Like, the montage is trying to calm you, but deep down you're like,
I was just gonna say that I thought this was a masterclass in tension building and juxtaposing tone. Ms. Harris did a beautiful job of establishing some really, really strong stakes and then showing in the next scene two young women having a great time. But as they're doing that, man, I'm really stressed out because I know, you know, once this good time is over, what price is she gonna pay for this? You know, the first thing I thought about when I saw this scene was that she made this movie for $100,000. How in the world did she shoot this? It's incredible what she's able to pull off with such a small budget.
It's so good. Just Another Girl in the IRT is very, very unique in how stylish it is and how black it is. And the only thing that I can really compare it to is, like, Mary J. Blige videos and stuff.
Yes.
Like that.
Yes. I also love this scene, especially because it's like, as a gay woman watching this, there's just a lot of straight energy that I don't like in this film. But I love this scene because finally all the men are leaving her alone. And there's, like, the one on the side, like, just trying to get a glimpse. Like, you'd be lucky if you saw what was happening in this dance circle right now.
Chantel, you're trouble
now. What?
Don't you ever do that again.
It was so interesting because most of the coming-of-age films I watched growing up were about white boys, and I always felt like they would always, like, get away with these things that I would never get away with. So watching coming of age films about black girls is just completely different. And even like watching a black girl deal with her body, like that was my big thing when I was a teen. I didn't know how to dress myself. I didn't know that I was like cute because I kept on wearing these clothes that like I saw like the preppy kids wear or whatever, and it just like didn't feel right, and I didn't know what to wear. I was just like confused. And like I feel like if I had seen Just Another Girl in IRT, I'd be like, okay, I could dress like this, I could do this, I could play around with this. And I think when you're young and you're a black girl, it's important to know what your options are and the kind of different person that you can be.
Totally.
Kevin, do you think that Cher and Chantel would be friends?
Absolutely not. I don't think that Chantel would give her the time of day.
Which I think is kind of funny, because even though they're like, in terms of identity, they're completely different in terms of how the world treats them and enacts harm on them and or enacts privilege on them. It's completely different. But they do have some similarities, like they love the pushing back at the teachers, being charismatic almost to the point of like putting on a show just because that's, you know, what you do for your friends, things like that. There are some like similarities I can see between them, but it certainly wouldn't lead me to think that they would be compatible.
And yeah, I was thinking about that when I was watching Just Another Girl in the IRT, how they like Cher, it's not like a huge plot point, but Cher actually makes really good grades. So they do have that in common where they're like high achievers, but the bar is different for both of them.
Yeah, and the way they're treated, it's like when Cher pushes back at her teacher, it's like, but then when Chantel pushes back, they're like, well, you're gonna get suspended or expelled. It's like, it, comparing the two movies just shows you like, being a black girl and being a white girl are obviously just completely different experiences, no matter the similarities in terms of like action or personality or whatever. It is absolutely canon, not just in like black women's cinema, which is where we so often see this film in terms of like programming, but just black cinema in general. It's so important. It's so important.
No, I agree. Just from just like purely a filmmaking perspective, here is a woman who scraped together $100,000 and made an incredible movie. And it's not regarded in the same way that, well, let's say Clerks or She's Gotta Have It or, you know, any other film that came out in the early 90s or late 80s from filmmakers who scraped together money and made an indie film. And this was a brilliant example because it was not as confined as those other films are. The world was much bigger, much more expensive, and she pulled it off in a really brilliant way. And I think people really need to use this as a masterclass of how to, you know, make a very good debut feature film that's reflective of your voice and your world with limited resources. So 100%, everybody put this film in your canon, please.
Thank you for watching Black Film School. Join us next time where we'll be talking about more Hollywood classics and different films to add to the canon.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.